Welcome to another edition of Transparency in Government. As always, we come on to tell you what's going on around town. You can ask us questions, you can send in issues that you think we should discuss. And today, as you've seen in the past, we have our town manager. And Kevin, how are things going?
Dottie, things are well since okay. We last spoke. It's been a little bit of
I think
time.
We skipped a month.
Think
something
we did
about
as well.
Elections and meet town meetings
was a
and
lot
things.
Going on.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, but catch people up.
Yeah, I mean, there's always a lot going on mm-hmm. around town. Of course, as you mentioned, we had our town elections.
Yes.
Back in March.
Mm-hmm. I just wish we had the same turnout for our town elections that we had for the primary.
Yeah, you know, and it's something, Dottie, that we struggle with all the time, and mm-hmm. it's how to get more people engaged yeah. in what's going on mm-hmm. in their town government.
Well, we're going to work on that because I think that they need to understand that when they go to the polls and vote for a presidential candidate,
yeah.
they have a voice.
Right.
But if they go and vote in a town election,
right.
they have a loud voice.
Yeah.
That's well, really going to affect what's happening around them.
And, you know, I mean, I guess you could look at it a couple of ways. You could say there's really a lack of, or there's really a lot of apathy and a lot of uninformed voters mm-hmm. or maybe people who just don't want to be engaged in town government.
But sometimes people just stay home because they think everything's going fine well, and they don't need to yell.
And I was just going to say, yeah. the other way of looking at it is, you know, people may feel things are going pretty well in mm-hmm. town and that they don't need to go out mm-hmm. Because, you know, the tax rate's steady. They like the direction the town is going in. And so, you know, in that sense, maybe mm-hmm. they just don't come out and vote because of that.
But it makes you have to, as a town manager, you have to have the ability to read people's minds. So why didn't
well,
they come out? Do we need to change
yeah,
things?
Yeah, so. And the other thing, too, is when you're talking about, you know, you have a town of roughly 25,000 mm-hmm. people, almost 17,000 registered voters.
Yeah.
And when, you know, any typical town council mm-hmm. or planning board meeting, you may get a total of 20 people mm-hmm. Who show up for something like that.
Yeah.
Sometimes less than that, and where a lot of the decisions are being made, whether mm-hmm. it's a council meeting mm-hmm. or a planning board meeting. That's one thing. And then, of course, on the voting, out of 17,000 voters, you get 2,000
mm-hmm.
That show up. You know,
yeah.
real lackluster amount of people. And what unfortunately happens in those circumstances, especially if it's a council or planning board meeting, is you have roughly a handful of people who are voicing their opinions, and you don't know, are they speaking for the rest of the town?
Yeah, how representative are they?
How representative are they?
Yeah.
They're obviously yeah. speaking their mm-hmm. own personal mm-hmm. view,
yeah.
but how many people do they represent?
And the elected official really needs to know that they've got to take a little time to find that sort of thing
right.
out versus just immediately reacting to the few people that came out to speak.
Right, and it, exactly. Yeah. And you don't ever want to overreact
right.
to it one way or the other.
We'll take that under advisement.
Yeah. Yeah.
Deal with it at the next meeting.
But then it's a matter of, okay, how do you gauge what the average citizen is thinking mm-hmm. out there
yeah.
and how do you understand that? And so, you know, it's something that, again, it's part of the reason we do this show.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We want to inform people as much as we possibly can mm-hmm. about what is going on in their town so that maybe at the very least, if they don't vote or don't show up to a planning board or, mm-hmm. or a council meeting, they're at least getting some information from
right.
here. Very interesting. I you know, read a couple of the Facebook group pages in town,
mm-hmm.
and I saw a post just the other day from someone who couldn't believe that there was this project called Woodmont Commons that was, you know, happening, and it was going to be a walk vote.
Isn't that kind of scary?
And, well, and again, you say, you know, are you not
How
reading the newspapers?
Not, no. yeah.
Are you not watching planning board
yeah.
meetings? And, you know, but the reality is you have a faction mm-hmm. of people out there who mm-hmm. maybe don't have time to do all this stuff. And so they're hearing about things word of mouth and then
yeah.
find out about it
yeah.
and say, how long has this mm-hmm. been going on mm-hmm. for? You know, and then you discover that it's been 5 years.
Yeah, and I'm going to take a minute to take
yeah.
a plug. Okay, you hear from us once a month and
right.
we go over things. But we've got a copy of the Londonderry Times sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
And they're quite detailed mm-hmm. articles on what's going on.
Right.
So that's a great place to start. And then watch us
Yep.
And then, you know, come to the meeting and talk if you want to speak
right.
up there.
So. Yeah. So, but anyway, so we had elections, and mm-hmm. as I said, pretty much everything did pass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, on the town side, there weren't a lot of articles that had a big tax impact.
Right.
You know, in terms of most of the things mm-hmm. that were on there were funded through the undesignated fund balance.
Yes, I noticed that.
For instance, the senior center expansion mm-hmm. that passed. And that work on that's going to start in July,
mm-hmm.
Which is great news for our senior community.
Now, is that expanding out behind where
yes.
it is now?
Yeah.
Okay. I just figured if they came too far to my side, I might be looking in their windows.
We're going to try to make it as least impactful, you know,
oh, they're great.
To your property.
They are. Yeah.
And, you know, and I'm very glad we're mm-hmm. going to be able to offer our seniors more programs because we're expanding the center.
Yeah.
And we're able to do it through no tax impact
mm-hmm.
with the fund balance. Same thing with the roadway maintenance
yeah.
trust
yeah.
fund, our vehicles,
mm-hmm.
You know, making sure we're keeping you know, having fresh
mm-hmm.
vehicles on
yeah.
the road when we need them, especially
yeah.
for our DPW and fire department. But all of these things passed.
Mm-hmm.
The management of the town forest.
Which passed? Excuse me, one second. The default or the?
The default budget
passed.
The default budget
was. What was the difference between the two?
$5,000, maybe, Donnie.
Yeah, okay.
Could have been less than that.
Yeah.
It wasn't a lot.
Yeah.
But the default budget passed. The management of the town forest
mm-hmm.
Was put in the hands now of the town manager.
Congratulations.
Now, I've always wanted a forest.
I bet you have.
Yeah, so now I
can't
got
see the
my
forest
own forest.
For the trees.
Yeah.
How's that go?
And, you know, we joke about mm-hmm. it being my forest. It's the community's forest. It's the town's forest. And we're talking about the woodlot behind mm-hmm. the town
I wonder
town
if they'll
common.
Build you one of those little towers where you can walk up there and,
Dottie,
and survey all of your...
A ranger hat will do it. That's
okay.
it. That's all I need. But the reality is it was under the management of the Conservation
yes.
Commission,
mm-hmm.
and now it's going to be under the town manager
mm-hmm.
with guidance from the Conservation Commission, mm-hmm. the Heritage Commission, and the Historic District as
okay.
well.
Now, are you going to actually start some projects that involve the town forest?
Well, you know, the big one right now has been making it more accessible.
Mm-hmm.
So putting some more trails in there. You know, I think what we've heard so far is no one wants it to be a park,
mm-hmm.
But people would like it to be more accessible, more usable.
Yeah.
And if folks haven't been through there yet, mm-hmm. I highly encourage them to do so.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of trails in there already.
Yeah.
I've got my hat goes off to Kent Allen in town.
Mm-hmm.
He's our
yeah, he's a great
cemetery
guy.
Sexton, but
yeah.
he's been cleaning up that
mm-hmm.
forest
mm-hmm.
A lot
yeah.
and has made it very usable. Handicapped accessible,
mm-hmm.
And it's a great little jewel for the town to
mm-hmm.
have. Many people probably don't realize they can walk behind the town common, and go on the trails
yeah.
behind there. And there's a lot of great lookout areas. There's a pond back there.
Mm-hmm.
There's an area where you can look over and sit by the orchards. Although
mm-hmm.
a number of the trees are now gone.
Gone.
But they'll be replanted.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a great resource to have
mm-hmm.
Back there. And so it'll evolve over time. I don't envision there being any drastic change overnight to that area.
Mm-hmm.
But as more feedback comes in, you know, it'll, mm-hmm. as I said, it'll
Will
evolve.
You be looking to the master plan for some guidance on that area?
Yes and no, Dottie. You know, the master plan was very progressive in that area
yes.
in that it really called for it to be urbanized,
mm-hmm.
had some new roadways
mm-hmm.
going through
mm-hmm.
it. And there was a lot of pushback that we got to really doing anything drastic against
mm-hmm.
doing anything drastic
yeah.
like that to the town
now,
common
that's
area.
One of those situations where who do you go with, because you've got the master plan, which got a lot of public input,
right?
They were out there asking anybody mm-hmm. to give their input, and now
so it's a great example.
You have a number of people that really don't want much, if any, progress out there.
It's a great example that you're right, there was a master plan committee
mm-hmm.
that put this master plan together with an outside consultant
right.
and you know there were a number of people that were on that committee, And then when it came time for, okay, let's see what things we want to implement in the master plan to, you know, if you're going to spend a lot of money putting a master plan together, you might as well use it.
Yeah.
And then so when the rubber hit the road, so to speak, and people maybe who weren't involved with the master plan realized that it called for the town center to become very urbanized, there was, again, a lot of pushback of, whoa, we don't want to change this section of Londonderry. You know, we want it to pretty much look the way it currently looks and not make it into a much more city-like area. So, you know, it's one of those situations where a lot of times people find out after the fact, but when they do find out, they say, I'm not sure that's the direction we want to go in. So, but, you know, as I said, the elections went fairly smooth. And we still got two more to go this year. We got a primary, a state primary in September.
Yep, that's right.
And then we, of course, have the big presidential election in November.
And I'm sure there'll be a big turnout again.
I have no doubt there'll be a big turnout for that. No doubt about it. So that's what's going on there. And I'm just going to pull up some of my notes here, Dottie, as we go through this stuff.
Well, you mentioned trees.
Yes.
Okay, you're talking about trees as far as the town forest is concerned. I'm riding around town, and it's like there are so many places that have just gone in and clear-cut an area. And I know that one of the reasons is they're going to do building on a lot or whatever, a parcel. It makes it easier for them to maneuver and get everything in. But then they go and plant trees again. Like, I just wish, and I know other people do too, that we could leave some of the nicer old ones and work around them a little bit.
You know, I mean, and there's a lot of clear cutting that happens too. Now, don't forget, in these areas where all that's taking place is clear cutting, so people are, you know, removing the timber from there, there's it provides for new growth to move in as well. So while you are removing some of the older trees in these forested areas, you are also providing an area of new growth.
Well, the only thing I've been seeing is a total clear cut.
To make way for development or just
clear
cutting? Because there are different areas where, in some cases, there's developments going in, and then there's other places where there's just clear cutting. They're just taking the timber out, but they're not developing anything in there. And if anyone has any questions about that, they can always call and just ask us. Because we do get calls from time to time from abutters who will call and ask, hey, is there a new development going in, or are they just taking some trees out? So if you're ever curious about that, people can call and ask us. We're happy to talk to them about it. Now, as we're still talking about trees being taken down, many folks have probably realized by now that there's been a lot of trees taken down between Pillsbury Road and Market Basket. In fact, as that redevelopment there starts to come to completion, which it's coming along pretty quick. The new store should be in by May. You'll see the old building completely come down this spring. In fact, they already have it partitioned off. And when that comes down, a lot of people are going to be surprised by what they see behind it, which is basically a clear shot all the way up to Pillsbury, as most of the trees have all been taken down. In anticipation of the first phase of the Woodmont Commons project. And that first phase will be mostly a commercial, the commercial downtown area of Woodmont Commons.
The walkable.
The walkable downtown, yep. So I would expect to see some dwelling units, not single family housing, but probably more in the like of accessory dwellings. So apartments
on top
of the stores. Maybe some townhomes.
Which happens in most cities, is you have that.
Right.
You have the businesses are on the first floor, and the second and third floors are apartments.
Right.
And that's usually a good affordable place for people to start out.
And no. I mean, you know, this we're anticipating this is going to be kind of a hotbed of activity where there's probably going to be a lot of demand for people to live there. And as
and
you know,
the prices.
Well, the higher the demand, the higher the prices are.
Yep.
So
just doesn't seem fair.
Well, it's it's all kind of the economics of it,
it is,
you know.
It is.
So, but what we are expecting is that sometime this summer, and I can tell you, the Woodmont team is diligently working behind the scenes to get their plans, you know, into a package. Mm-hmm. Probably sometime this summer, we will see a site plan submittal to the planning board for that first phase. A number of buildings, again, mostly commercial type buildings. It is exciting. And a lot of people are asking, what's going on? Is this ever going to happen? Mm-hmm. And again, by this summer, people will start to see the real conceptualized plan start to take shape.
And I noticed that going up Gilchrist and that one just ran out of my head.
Pillsbury?
No, the other road that goes across Woodmont. I can't think of it in there. But anyway, I've noticed that they've cut down a lot of the apple trees, but they seem to be leaving what looks right now like a buffer.
Yep.
Is that?
That was part of the plan.
Okay.
Part of the development plan calls to have a few rows buffer of apple trees that had to be.
And that helps a lot.
It does.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, and that's by design.
Yeah, I think people have been absolutely amazed at how large that tract of land is.
Yeah. It is. It's very large.
When the trees are gone, you can look all the way out. It's
right.
A lot of land.
Yeah, it is a lot of land. So that's starting to take shape. That's happening. Finishing up this year will be the assisted living community. That's almost ready to open. Mm-hmm. I think that opens sometime this summer.
Is that one up behind Avandi's up there?
Behind Avandi's, off of 102. Mm-hmm. And then I think the first of the senior living apartments will also be opening up behind
there. I took a ride through that complex a couple of weeks ago. Whoa, it's huge.
Yeah, it is. It's
huge.
A lot. Yeah, it is. It's a lot of... you know, a lot of new units there. Mm-hmm. Those will be opening this summer. The Wallace Farm workforce housing units, that's 240 units, half 50% workforce, 50% market. Those are behind the Sleep-In.
Yep.
If people are wondering what's going on behind there, those are new apartment buildings that are going to be built behind there. And then the other one off of Stonehenge, similar size project, that's still making its way through the planning pipeline. They've formally submitted plans. They're still in design review with staff right now. But I expect by this summer they'll have completed plans and we'll be able to move forward.
It just seems like there's so much going on.
There is
building and
there is there is a lot going on right now, and you know, it ebbs and flows.
Right.
5 years ago, the market was stale. You know, we were still coming out of the recession, and right now you still have a bull market as far as real estate goes, and so developers and builders are getting all of their plans in while they can. two of the bigger industrial projects that people will also see under construction this summer is the FW Webb building, the million square foot building up by the airport off of Pettengill Road. You know, they're again moving through the planning board process right now. We expect that they'll be able to begin construction by this summer, if not earlier than that.
So a little more tax revenue.
There'll be a lot more tax revenue there. That's not just a little more, that's a lot more tax revenue. Mm-hmm. And then also off of Pettengill is, they haven't revealed the name yet.
Okay.
And I'm not gonna even get into the reasons why. It has to do with a lease agreement they're working out with the airport. But I can tell you the project's very much still alive. It's this close to having it all be signed and construction starting. Okay. I wouldn't be surprised if construction started next month because they're all approved. The planning board's approved the whole plan.
Okay.
You know, this is a manufacturing plant, West Coast based company, 500 jobs. And will be great for the area. Again, a big revenue driver into the town. Another real newly approved project, a big one, is the two building six-story high-rises of apartments. And amazing that the zoning board approved six stories to
be
built.
I was just gonna say, how does the fire department feel about that? Don't we have to have certain size ladder trucks when we have a building that size? Because right now we don't have anything.
Dottie, I would love to see Al Sipek's face right now behind this wall.
Yeah, that's true.
Do you know what date it is?
Yes, it's April Fool's Day.
So I'm joking about the six-story high-rises. I think there was a collective,
okay.
What? How come none of us heard about this?
I had to throw it in, Dottie.
I got to keep you sharp, Dottie, and I had to make sure, you know.
That's okay.
Hopefully the people watching at home didn't flick their channel, though, after they, you know, just heard me announce
sometimes
it.
I tell people it's really not a challenge to fool me. Okay, so it's silly. But I have to tell you one quick April Fool's thing.
Yes, please.
Okay, for years, we're talking like maybe 7 or 8 years, I lived in Chester, I had horses, and my mother would wake me up, which I didn't wake up easily back in my teenage years. My mother would wake me up and she said, Dottie, hurry up and get outside, the horses are loose. And I'd fly out of bed and get dressed and run outside, and as I'm going out the door, she's going, April Fool. Every year, how could you fall for that every year? So see, it's no challenge, but.
Well, it made it fun for her, obviously.
Obviously. But yeah, Al, when you said six stories, I was thinking about Al as well. So
there's no six-story high-rise or anything close to it.
We repeat, that was a joke.
Coming to Londonderry, we have zoning against mm-hmm. that sort of thing.
But we also have, along the same subject that we're talking about here, you now have a town planner.
We do. We do have a town planner. Her name's Colleen Mayu. Mm-hmm. She actually will start on April 4th. Monday, April 4th. Oh, it is it?
Yes.
Oh, well, happy early birthday to you, Dottie.
Mm-hmm, thank you. I advertise so people can celebrate as long as they want to.
Wow, that's great news. We should have celebrated with a cake here today. So we're excited about her starting. Mm-hmm. You know, our last planner, Cynthia May, left at the end of December. So we're happy to get Colleen on board. Mm-hmm. She comes to us by way of Amherst and Bedford.
Okay.
Is very, very well regarded in the planning community. Mm-hmm.
And has she held that job specifically in other communities?
She has. She was an assistant planner in Bedford.
Okay.
And she was the community development head in mm-hmm. Amherst.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
she can hit the ground running.
Oh, yeah. And she's well aware of a lot of the projects Londonderry mm-hmm. has going on right now. And, we're excited to be getting her on board. And I think she'll be a great fit for the staff and a great fit for the community mm-hmm, as well. Mm-hmm. Just a sharp person, and
should lighten your load just a little bit too, don't you think?
Well, it'll definitely be a help having her on board, and mm-hmm. I think the staff in the planning mm-hmm. office is very much looking forward to her coming on board as well.
That's good.
So,
okay.
Very happy about that. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the story on the development mm-hmm. front right now. Let's look what else we have on the list here.
Well, we've done elections, we've done trees, we've done development.
Let me go into another issue that hasn't really affected Londonderry at this point, but may come up.
Okay.
There have been reports recently about some well water contamination in the towns of Merrimack and Litchfield.
Mm-hmm.
And it all stems from, there's a plastics plant, St. Gobain's in Merrimack.
Yeah.
And what they found is a couple of the wells tested right near the plant
mm-hmm.
Tested extremely high of a certain contaminant called PFOA.
Mm-hmm. So they think it's leaching from that plant
in
some way?
Yeah, they do. But it's an airborne, but it's carried, the contaminant's carried through the air. So, which, you know, because I'm sure some people thought, well, the plant's in Merrimack. There's mm-hmm. a river that divides Merrimack and Litchfield.
Right.
How did it get to Litchfield?
Yeah.
So it travels through the air. So what the Department of Environmental Services has done is they tested the water wells mm-hmm. in a mile radius mm-hmm. of the plant. Now, that mile radius does not include anywhere in Londonderry.
Okay.
It's close to the Londonderry line mm-hmm. Around Corning Road. You're going from Litchfield Road into Corning.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't touch Londonderry. So far, the wells closest that have been tested, closest to the Londonderry line,
mm-hmm.
Have tested below the alarm rate, below 100.
Mm-hmm.
And so only the homes that are testing over 100 are being given bottled water right now mm-hmm. as a precaution. the EPA doesn't really have a formalized set of rules on this particular contaminant. Mm-hmm. So things are more gray than if it were other types of contaminants. Mm-hmm. That being said, the general rule of thumb is if it's over 100, you know, you may want to avoid drinking the water, hence mm-hmm. the bottled
Why
water.
Take a chance?
That's if it's above 100. If it's below 100, mm-hmm. you don't have to worry as much.
Right.
Our concern obviously has been, do they believe they need to move the testing into Londonderry? Mm-hmm. So we've been in close contact with DES, and they're keeping us apprised of the situation. What they basically said is they're gonna look at all the results that they get back mm-hmm. from this 1 mile radius, and then make a determination whether or not they need to expand that further, that mm-hmm. radius further, which then may include Londonderry. At this time, they have not made that determination.
Let's say it's airborne. With the winds we've been having for the last 2 or 3 days, it's probably all the way out to the coast right now.
Well, but
people
have to understand that the part that was emitting this from the plant, mm-hmm, that's mm-hmm. been taken care of. The plant itself is mm-hmm. is mitigating that.
Oh, okay, so those emissions are not happening?
No.
Okay,
That we know that of. They're not know. Happening yeah. at this yeah. point. Once they found these mm-hmm. other wells, mm-hmm. and this was, you know, a while back.
Yeah.
Once they found those wells, mm-hmm. then they took all the precautions in the plant that they had to take to make sure it wasn't emitting anything more.
Good to know.
So, you know, I know what you're saying about the winds the last few days. Do we have to worry about that? I don't think we do. But that being said, mm-hmm. you know, DES right now is the lead agency mm-hmm. on this.
And they would advise you if they thought it was coming into town.
If they thought Londonderry, they had to start testing the mm-hmm. wells in Londonderry. Mm-hmm. And again, I think they'll be looking at how did those wells.
Yeah, it's
in the mile radius.
It seems
test.
Odd to me that if it's airborne, why wells?
Because what happens is the contaminant settles into the ground.
Okay.
And then once it
leaches in.
I mean, it's in the air, but then it comes down, mm-hmm. hits the ground, mm-hmm. and then it settles mm-hmm. in and leaches into the, mm-hmm. could leach into the groundwater.
Okay.
So that's why.
Okay.
But I just want to give that update mm-hmm. so that people, I have to tell you, I've actually only had one resident in mm-hmm. Londonderry contact me about this.
Yeah.
Though there may be others that are wondering about it. So I just wanted to give.
It wouldn't surprise me, especially with right now all the stuff we keep hearing about Flint, Michigan.
Right.
You know, to be listening to all of that and seeing the horrible situation those people are in.
Yeah.
That would probably make people want to pay a little bit closer attention to something.
Well, and just so you're aware, I mean, the town was very proactive about this, mm-hmm. even though the initial test came out as Merrimack and Litchfield. Mm-hmm. You know, I directed the staff immediately, let's call DES, let's
find
call Penobscot Water, let's call Manchester, mm-hmm. and find out what's going on, and be proactive about it, and make sure that right mm-hmm. now in Londonderry there isn't anything more we should be doing.
Okay.
You know, let's not wait for them to come to us and say, okay, we got to test the wells.
Sounds like a good plan.
See, you know, so we're being proactive about it, and we'll continue to update the public as more information comes in.
Sounds
on that.
Good. Did you have something else on your list?
Let's see, I'm sure there was. I would mention that, you know, we're always looking for more volunteers.
Committees.
You know, typically we get some vacancies throughout mm-hmm. the year, but typically at the end of the year, term expiration dates come up for mm-hmm. people and there's mm-hmm. turnover.
Yeah.
So we're always looking to get more volunteers. Mm-hmm. The big committee we want to get more volunteers for right now is Beautify Londonderry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's
That almost went down
almost
in flames.
It
and
did.
Then
thankfully, some people stepped
out of the
in
ashes,
and they're reviving the group.
Mm-hmm.
So there's times throughout the year mm-hmm. they get together and go around town and as many people, you know, contact
it's
my office.
It's usually only a couple of weekends, isn't it?
I think they do four weekends a year.
Yeah.
But, you know, just outside of those 4 weekends, mm-hmm. there may be other projects that mm-hmm. cleanup projects that need to be done in town. They're willing to volunteer.
Yeah.
But, you know, it takes really a, you know, our DPW guys, mm-hmm. you know, they plow the roads in the winter. They do road reconstruction mm-hmm. projects.
Yep.
they're not trash picker-uppers. Now, I will say,
we can't use them that way.
Sometimes people leave big items. Mm-hmm. We'll go and remove those things because we don't want trash on the side of the road. But the reality is that we rely on volunteers to help us as well. And to the extent that people can volunteer their time, join Beautify Londonderry, and we can send, you know, hordes of people out to pick up the litter on the side of the roads. And just, you know, we're all responsible for keeping the town clean.
And I was just throwing an ad. Somebody was asking me the other day about, well, how do I get rid of this? How do I get rid of that? I can't put it out on the curb. Don't just throw it out. Don't drop it on the side of the road. Call.
Right.
And the Solid Waste Committee has a whole list of who will take what, and there isn't anything that can't get disposed of somewhere.
Right. Exactly.
So don't throw it out.
Yes. No. Definitely
where it doesn't
not
belong.
Right.
Yeah.
And speaking of that, you may have heard some recent news recently about we're changing the recycling, how we do recycling in town. And
because right now we don't have to sort it at all.
Right. And you're still not going to have to sort it going forward. Here's the change.
Okay.
And here's the entire scoop on it, because the initial information that went out made it sound like we were cutting pickup in half.
Mm-hmm.
What's happened is, so right now we'll give out the red bins to people that want
them. Same as we've always had,
They're 18-gallon bins. Mm-hmm. And so what we're now moving to is an automated recycling system under the new contract that'll start July 1st. People are going to get 96-gallon recycling
barrels, more like the trash barrels?
Like the trash ones.
Okay.
They're going to be 96 gallons.
Okay.
All right. Five times the size as the small bins.
Okay.
Now, in turn, what we're doing is we're going to move to every other week in recycling, picking it up.
Okay.
So, bigger gallons, you can fit more in, but we're moving to every other week.
So you put your cardboard, your paper, your plastic,
all of that.
Your
you can
glass.
Still, all goes in the same bin. You don't have to sort it. Mm-hmm. No single stream recycling.
Overflow.
Yes.
What if you have overflow? Would it be the same situation where you would buy bags for overflow?
If you're going to consistently have overflow, so you won't have bags, but you can buy a second barrel.
Oh, okay.
If you're a family of six or more, you're going to be given a second barrel.
Okay.
If you're not that size,
let's see, me, two cats, and no, we don't make it.
But if you're not that size family, but you go through a lot of recycling, you're gonna do more than the 96 gallons. You can buy a second barrel for a one-time fee of $50.
Okay.
So people who want to do that can choose to do that. And if you have oversized cardboard, and you don't want to cut it up to put it in, you can bring it to the drop-off center on Saturdays.
Okay.
And, you know, they take cardboard there. So people are welcome to drop stuff off there. So, you know, with any change, you hear, you know, grumblings here and there about it. But much like our trash pickup now, you know, that was a big change that was done before. Things work pretty smoothly. Same thing here, you know, and a big part of the reason we're moving to the every other week is it's actually saving the town $1 million over 5 years to do that. So instead of it being about $3.5 million, it's only about $2.5 million.
Sounds good.
Picking up and disposing of garbage and recyclables costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
And you know, we recently went out to bid on these contracts, and it's expensive.
Yeah.
And the contract prices have gone way up. So, you know.
And we would still be in a position where we have to go to the drop-off center to get rid of anything that's not recyclable.
Correct. Any any large items, you know, that's not trash, but large items you have.
Computer, air conditioner.
Right.
Yeah.
Those all go to the drop-off center.
And there still is a fee associated with dropping them off. Is that
depending
right?
Depending on what the item
is.
Yeah.
And again, to find that out, they can go online.
Go to the website. DPW website, and all the information's right on the Public Works
and
website.
I will say,
or they can call the Public Works Department as well.
Right. And I will say that I've noticed that Donna in the Public Works Department is very good at making sure the information gets put on TV.
Yes.
On the scroll.
Right.
So, but
yeah.
Sounds like a good plan. I'm willing to save $2.5 million.
Hey, it's a million dollars.
A million dollars.
It's still a lot of money.
Yeah.
And, you know, as I said, I think as people find as they use the new system, mm-hmm. they'll find it to be very convenient having those larger size mm-hmm. barrels.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
So, a lot going on.
There is a lot going yeah. on. What else do we, just trying to think if there's anything else happening right now. I would like to just remind people, we were talking about volunteers for committees earlier, mm-hmm. and I would just like to remind people that the website is the place to go again. If you think there's something that you would like to get involved with, some committee that you feel you have an expertise or an opinion or whatever it is you can add to that committee, look on the website.
Right.
The last time I looked, the volunteers that were needed were right on the front page.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can go there. There's an easy application to fill out saying why right. do you want to be a member of this committee? And it doesn't mean you have to have a PhD in that topic. Just what is it that you want to accomplish?
Yeah.
Some people just want to participate and help as much as they can
right.
in whatever's going on.
Right. So. And, you know, and if folks want to know what is available, mm-hmm. how they can volunteer,
yeah.
Calling Kirby Wade in my office
mm-hmm. yeah.
Is a great way to find that information. Mm-hmm. She usually has that information readily available
yes.
and
yeah.
can give it out. So yeah. people are welcome to 432-1100.
Extension 120.
120. They'll get all that information.
That hasn't changed in 20 years.
Exactly. Yeah.
So do you think we've about covered everything that's been going on?
I think
recently?
We have. Yeah. I think we've okay. covered a lot of the issues.
Okay.
And in fact, I'll be back in a month.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'll see about doing is bringing on perhaps our new town planner.
Sounds good.
And people can meet mm-hmm. her as well.
Okay. I do have one other question
yes.
I wanted to ask you about. I believe this past too, to hire someone to work in town with addiction issues?
Correct, yes. Thank you for raising that, Dottie. So one of the articles that did pass was appropriating $50,000 mm-hmm. to have someone to mediate, maybe not even mediate, but be more of a clearinghouse.
Okay, because mediation is something that we
yeah.
did many years ago, and it was a totally different kind of
right.
program. So
this would be someone to act as a clearinghouse mm-hmm. to work with families mm-hmm. who are dealing with addiction issues.
Mm-hmm.
As we know, the heroin mm-hmm. opioid problem is, mm-hmm. you know, it's become a large issue in
yeah.
New Hampshire. And every community is affected mm-hmm. by it, including Londonderry. So it was a Warren article that was put on to appropriate $50,000
mm-hmm.
For that purpose to, a lot of times families don't know where to go for help.
They don't.
And they don't know what services are out there,
mm-hmm.
you know, what's being offered.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is so that if there is a family in need in town for that mm-hmm. purpose, they will be able to go to this person and find out where they can get help,
right.
how they can find all this stuff out.
Mm-hmm. There's one other thing I'm going to give a plug for today, too, and I'll probably do something more extensive on this at a later date on the One Voice at a Time show that I also produce. There is, and a lot of people don't know about this, but there is kind of a hotline in every state. So if you're in New Hampshire and you dial 211,
mm-hmm.
you go directly to this office that is, talk about a clearinghouse for information, you just call them up, tell them what it is you're looking for, probably the area of the state that you live in, what you're looking for, and they will give you the resources. They'll tell you where to go for whatever
right.
thing it is that you need, and they're amazing. I don't know how they have that much information at their fingertips, but you mention what you want, and in a half a second, they start to run down the list of who can help you with that. So it's a service that's been around for several years, and it just, I can't tell you how many times I've turned someone on to that number and wondered, like, in these other things, how did they not know that?
Yes.
Yeah. It's just so, we used to have, what did we call it? The governor's hotline.
Yeah.
And that was this, a state-initiated thing, and it worked very well, very similar to this, but this one is just really fast, and they
yeah.
know everything that's going on. So,
excellent.
Although I did notice that CART is not in their list of transportation, so we'll have to make sure they know that. I think we've done a pretty good job catching
two.
Everybody
yeah,
up.
I think we have too.
It's 2016. We know that.
We've
done all the things we're supposed to
we're
do.
We're 3 months in already.
Yep, and we'll be coming back to tell you what else is going on in a month.
That sounds great.
Yep. So please feel free, as always, to give either Kevin a call or myself. let us know what it is you're interested in, what you need more information on, and we would be glad to talk about that.
And by the way, I should mention too, we have an anonymous suggestion box at Town Hall. And there's a pad of paper there where people
right in the foyer.
Right in the foyer area. So if people have suggestions, maybe they don't want to put their name to it, but they want to suggest something, they're more than welcome to drop their suggestion in there.
I love suggestion boxes, because that's exactly what happens if somebody doesn't want to necessarily bring it out and have it be contentious. They just like to raise it and get it resolved. So those work well for that. So check for the information on how to get in touch with us at the end of the show. And I hope that you'll join us next time. Thank you.